Good morning, church. Welcome to worship here from Living Waters Lutheran Church in Lino Lakes, Minnesota. It's a blessing to be with you this day as we are reminded that we are loved by God, that we are saved through what Jesus does for us on the cross, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we're called back out into the world to share God's love and grace with everyone we come in contact with today. Today, we are focusing on how is it that we live together when conflict arises, especially conflict within the church? Jesus lays out for us in Matthew 18 a way in which we can address conflict. And so much of it is having conversation with one another when we are hurt, offended, when we hear things that we don't quite understand. For us to seek reconciliation, to seek relationship with one another, and to do that with open hearts and open ears. So as we enter into worship this day, let us be reminded that God goes with us when we have those difficult conversations, when we are in the midst of uncomfortable conflict, that wherever two or three are gathered, God in Christ is there with us. So let us join in worship this morning as we lay our lives in the hands of Jesus who loves us abundantly. Let us worship. Let us confess and come before God in this time of worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you will provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. In your spirit, lead us so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us now live in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has already been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Bearing all my sins.
Let us pray. Compassionate God, we recognize our world is a broken place, hurt by poverty, famine, and disease. We admit that sometimes we make the world a broken place, tolerating prejudice, conflict, and self-interest. We confess that our hearts also suffer with anger, resentment, and jealousy. Renew us in your love, O God, and heal us with the comfort of your abundant love. Awaken us to the role we can play in healing your creation. Strengthen us through the power of your Holy Spirit to hear your word and move forward in faith. Amen. A reading from Romans chapter 13, verses 8 through 14. Owe no one anything except to love one another, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not commit murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and other commandments are summed up in this word, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does not do wrong to the neighbor, therefore. Love is the fulfillment of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is and how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleeping. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Here ends the reading. I'd like to invite the children to come forward closer to the screen wherever you are watching for the children's sermon. Today in the scripture passages, we're going to be hearing about identity. Who are we and who is Jesus? And so it made me wonder, there are lots of titles that I have. I am a daughter, I am a mother, I am a wife, I am a student, I am a pastor. But the one important piece of my identity that I sometimes forget about is that I am a child of God, and that God loves me with all of God's being, loves me beyond what I can understand. And so today I want us to remember that we each are children of God. And so here are some friends to remind us that we each are children of God.
I'm a child of God.
I'm a child of God.
All right, I am a child of God.
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 I'm a child of God.
I am a child of God.
The gospel for us to reflect on this day comes from the gospel of Matthew, the 18th chapter, verses 15 through 20. Jesus is speaking to his followers and he says this, "If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such one of these to you be as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly, I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." Here ends the gospel for us this day. Will you bow your heads in prayer with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts, O Lord, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, We live in the finest state in the land, I think. I love Minnesota. You can't take more than 3 steps without stepping into a lake. Our communities are lush with green trees and the air is clean. Our North Shore is beautiful and our farmland is rich and plentiful. We get to experience all 4 seasons, people. 4 seasons. Summer right now, oh, it's beyond belief weather-wise. Fall is gorgeous and colorful. Spring brings new life and a new start. And even the winter has the power to bring about delight outside of those frigid temperatures. Minnesota is a fine place to live. But if we're honest, it also comes with some challenges. Challenges beyond the external environments in which we live. Challenges to how we interact with one another, how we communicate, and sometimes how there's a lack of good, healthy communication. We pride ourselves, right, on being Minnesota nice. We've all heard this, which on the surface seems so kind and accepting. And yet when we delve deeper, when we dive deeper, it is often ripe with passive-aggressive behaviors, with sharp words spoken under our breath, and having adverse feelings about conflict in general. I get it. I totally get it. And frankly, I've been caught up in that same cycle of conversations where it seems it's just easier to walk away or to bite your tongue or to grin and bear it instead of letting a harsh word escape your lips or an action to be addressed that has hurt your feelings or a misunderstanding to continue to fester. Instead of having the courage to address it head on and in that moment, because heaven forbid we offend someone. So we get caught up in this tension, right? We get caught up in this tension that is created when there is a misunderstanding, when we are quick to jump to a conclusion that was never spoken, when we assume we know what the intentions of the other person are without asking a question, without seeking clarity. We'd rather be silent than to be uncomfortable and in that space of tension around the truth. Mix our Minnesota nice with this increasing instances online of this call out and cancel culture, where people feel emboldened to, from behind their keyboards, to call out in harsh and harmful ways the behaviors of those who they deem unworthy. Or, in the way of cancel culture, if you are a celebrity and you make one offhand comment or act in one imperfect way, the internet trolls decide that they have the power and the influence to ruin one's life. Between our passive-aggressive tendencies and the supposed anonymity, which the internet offers, we've become complacent. When faced with conflict and combative, and we become combative and ready to rumble without a place between, in between, to engage in healthy and moderate ways, which can lead to understanding and reconciliation. Think about it. How often have we been in contentious conversations, maybe about politics or the coronavirus or plans for the schools to reopen for our children, our teachers, and our communities? When has it been and where have we listened only to hear the next piece that will bring our attack? Or bring our defense, instead of really listening, instead of seeking to understand where that person is coming from, seeking to understand their perspective and how they got there, instead of channeling our own inner teenager and looking at them and responding, well, that's dumb, or frankly, saying something even worse. Conflict is hard. Course corrections and performance reviews can easily feel like criticism instead of constructive conversation. And we'd rather not face those things, not face those uncomfortable feelings of what when conflict brings, because they make us stammer and stutter our way through the words that we feel we need to speak. I know very few people, especially in ministry, who would say that they love conflict or that they thrive within it. And yet it is part of our lives, part of our relationships in all kinds of varying degrees. And it all comes down to communication, doesn't it? And admitting that we can't read each other's minds and we only know each other's hearts to a certain degree, a certain depth. But we do know, what it means to love one another and to seek the best for the other, to think the best of the other, and to want to maintain the connections with one another, because that is how we truly thrive. How we find meaning is in those relationships and in those connections. It's how we create this gathered community of the church and maintain it as a safe and sacred place and space for all of God's children, for all of our siblings in Christ, regardless of opinion and opportunity. Until we allow ourselves space to tune our ears to the hearts of one another, thinking the best of their intentions and seeking to understand what they are really saying, we need to be willing to ask questions, clarifying questions. Otherwise, we will continue to swirl and spin in this unproductive and destructive dance of conflict, succumbing to the idea that canceling those who are different than us, canceling those who hurt us, is the best way to navigate. As we hear in the gospel today, dealing with conflict and disagreement, especially within the gathered community of God's people, has been an issue for much longer than this last presidential cycle. It's been taking place long before fake news and cancel culture became part of our discourse. It's been part of how we negotiate the entirety of our lives, from our marital relationships to raising children, caring for our aging parents, living beside neighbors from all kinds of backgrounds, and ultimately walking in a highly diverse world. That's one thing that I so appreciate about Jesus and the stories that we hear about how he navigated life in the Bible. Not only was he the incarnate word and love of God let loose in the world, but because Jesus was fully human, he got it. He understood what conflict felt like and how damaging it could be to our relationships when we aren't mindful of being fully present with and honest about what is taking place in real time and in this moment. Jesus sets for us in the passage today certain rules for the road when it comes to living together as God's people, as members of God's church. When one sins against you, when one disagrees with you, when one is harsh to you or offends you, Jesus says, go. Go to that person and share your hurt. Ask a question for clarity about what was said. Seek to understand where that comment, where those actions are coming from. Because 9 times out of 10, our intent with our words doesn't always come out right. Maybe not the right wording for another to understand. Maybe our actions are received by another in a way that we had never planned. Halfway through my first call up in Brainerd, I was confronted with this firsthand. One Sunday, I went off script from my sermon and made an offhanded comment which I thought was further clarifying my intent. Between services, my colleague mentioned to me that I should be mindful about what I'm saying in my sermon, but he didn't elaborate. At the second service, I didn't say the same thing because it wasn't in my script. When I arrived in the office the next day, my colleague was waiting for me. And he called me into his office and shared with me that several parishioners talked to him after church and called him that afternoon about my offhanded comment. I was shocked. I was hurt and frantically trying to remember what I had said that would have offended so many people. And even after my colleague shared with me what the offensive phrase was, I was still unclear about it because the meaning of the phrase didn't carry the same definition for my generation as it did for the generations before me. I was appalled. I was appalled by my perceived intentions and embarrassed beyond belief. And all I wanted to do was to reach out to those that I offended to offer apologies and repentance. But my colleague stopped me and simply said, "Now that it has been brought to my attention and that I am sorrowful about it, nothing more needs to be done. The problem was resolved. It's time to move forward because I accepted that I was in the wrong. I repented, and that was all that was necessary." Course corrections and taking responsibility for one's actions are essential for this conflict resolution framework that Jesus talks about in order for it to work. And it's essential for us to speak up and to share when we are hurt, first with the person who hurt us, and only then moving forward to bring others alongside, and then to bring the church alongside, if that continues to go unheard. But we too often short-circuit this framework because we are much more comfortable talking to someone else about the situation or sitting in silence, ignoring the hurt that is festering until resentment takes hold and the destruction has set in, instead of going directly to that person, to the source of the conflict, and clearing the air. Jesus set a framework for believers to follow where conflict doesn't have to cancel the relationship, nor does it have to end the connection, as long as we are willing to address the hurt, the misunderstanding, the hurt, you hurt my feelings, emotion, with active listening, with reconciliation in mind, instead of the call out and cancel form that we so often go to. We need to be able to have these honest conversations and be able to truly hear one another in order to continue to live together in healthy ways. Dealing with conflict isn't easy. It requires sensitivity and compassion. It demands care in the midst of emotional discord. It means that we must care more about our relationship than we do about feeling 100% comfortable or even 100% right. It means having the courage to speak your heart and trusting that you will be heard and held in hope. And that is where one of our favorite verses comes into play. At the conclusion of this passage, we hear these words, "For wherever two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." Such words of comfort in many situations, but taken within the context in which it belongs, we can take heart when we face conflict. We can take heart when we face that conflict head on, that we do not enter into that kind of uncomfortable conversation alone. But instead, Jesus is right there beside us, providing the courage to speak, the words to say, and the strength to clear the air, to find clarity, and to seek understanding. Always working towards reconciliation with one another. So in whatever conflict you are facing this week, remember this: Christ gives us the courage to speak and the strength to listen, and hearts that seek to listen and love one another as we navigate our way through this life together. And that when we face our conflicts head on, We will never be asked to do this hard work alone, that Christ promises to go with us. Thanks be to God. Amen. We are reminded that all of the gifts that we have, all the riches that we possess, all the skills and gifts that we share with the world are actually ways of being faithful and following what God asks to share our gifts of both financial and time and talents with the world. And so we give thanks this day for all of the financial gifts that are given to Living Waters Lutheran Church so that we can do what God is asking us on this corner of the world. Thanks be to God. Amen. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Unite your church, O God. Grant us the gifts of repentance and reconciliation. Give us courage and compassion when we face conflicts, and help us to seek to restore our relationships to places of health and meaning. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Protect your creation, O God. Teach us ways that do not harm what you have entrusted to our care. Renew and enliven places of suffering from drought, flood, storm, pollution, and fire, especially those places like California, the Louisiana coast, and places where typhoons and hurricanes are coming ashore in Latin America and East Asia. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Turn nation and leaders from ways that lead to destruction and death. Shape new paths towards peace and cooperation. Teach us to recognize one another as neighbors and as co-creators with you. guide legislators, civil servants, judges, and police towards laws that protect the well-being of all, and empower each of us to be responsible citizens and neighbors towards one another. Watch over all our first responders, police and fire department personnel, and hospital staff as they use their gifts to help in time of need. And here at home, we ask you to watch over our military personnel serving both at home and overseas as they are protecting our freedoms. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we are on the cusp of a new school season, we are reminded that this is a school year unlike any we've ever experienced. Grant children and youth and families a sense of courage and grace. Be with our teachers and our administrators as they are seeking to do what is best. And invite all of us to take a moment and recognize that we are doing the best that we can. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Tend to all who are in need of your compassion, O Lord. Hear the cries of those awaiting justice and those yearning for forgiveness. Give community to the lonely and neighbors to the outcast. Shelter all who are vulnerable in mind, body, and spirit. We ask you especially, Lord, to be with Chelsea and her family, with Janet and Katie, and Alan, Ron, Terry, Ken, Bennett, Rebecca, Tom, Colleen, Leah, Sue, Linnea, Danielle, and all those we name in the quiets of our hearts at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sustain us in our work, O God, and give work to those who need it. Shape societies to ensure fair treatment for all who labor. Help us to love our neighbors in and through our work. We ask your blessing on all our essential workers who have continued to work on the front lines, at checkout lanes, in grocery stores, at gas stations, and in public works. Protect and guide them during these uncertain days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you see we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen.
So let's pray the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, receive God's blessing. By your hands may love be shared. By your voice may truth be spoken. And by your ears may truth be heard. And by your love may the song of Christ be sung. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's do this together, shall we, church? As we end our worship, let us go in peace to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.